present Gil Loescher, visiting professor, University of Oxford, Refugee Studies Center, for the honorary degree, Doctor of Humane Letters.
Gil Loescher, unflinching scholar and dedicated educator, you have shown an undaunted commitment not only to illuminating the troubled corners of our globe, but to seeking answers to the questions that most challenge humanity. Your courage in the pursuit of truth and knowledge are qualities that we hope Laurentians will emulate on whatever path they choose. You have dedicated yourself to imparting knowledge. You taught at the University of Notre Dame for more than 25 years, and still teach today at institutions around the world, including Princeton and Oxford. But your classrooms extend far beyond those walls, from the corridors of presidential palaces to the rugged pathways of refugee camps. Your students are not just curious young people, but presidents and general secretaries, high commissioners and prime ministers. You have edited or authored more than 20 books on refugee policy and penned many seminal articles and chapters. In the lead up to the Iraq War, you issued well-researched, sobering warnings about the effects of such a conflict on creating a generation of displaced persons. Your singular expertise in refugee policy and devotion to seeking truth drew you to Iraq in August of 2003. There you sat down for a meeting with the United Nations High Commissioner for Refugees and Special United Nations Envoy to Iraq that would change the course of your life, but not your commitment to your life's work. You survived a blast that those around you did not. You bear its scars to this day, but far from preventing you from continuing your quest for truth, you declared that you grew more determined. That is evident in a research trip you undertook barely a year after you sustained your injuries, making an arduous trek for thousands of miles along the remote and nearly inaccessible Thai-Burmese border to visit refugee camps, hear the voices of the people, and study long-term displacement. Your scholarship, embodying the extraordinary combination of empathy and empiricism, continues. Its importance is recognized by world governing bodies, research institutions, and major grant-making organizations. Your studies, articles, and books shape discourse and inform policy in a world that struggles with ever more pronounced challenges this generation is preparing to meet. In recognition of your courage and conviction, and the extent to which you embody the spirit and the letter of the educational mission of Lawrence University, and by the authority vested in me, I now confer upon you the degree of Doctor of Humane Letters, honoris causa, and admit you to its rights, privileges, and obligations. Congratulations, Gil.
Before leaving Oxford to come here, a colleague of mine told me about a book tour he made a few years ago to university campuses across the United States. He said of all the places he visited, from Ivy League colleges in the East to the best universities in the West, the students at Lawrence were the most welcoming, most interesting, and most engaged of all. So, I feel very privileged to be here speaking to such a challenging group of people. Later this summer, I will be celebrating the 50th reunion, yes, 50th reunion, of my own college graduating class. At the time I graduated, I wasn't sure what I wanted to do in life. I stood 6'8" tall, had been on a basketball scholarship throughout college, and had loved my major subjects of study, political history and international relations. The one thing I was sure of was that I didn't want to be just an armchair academic. I wanted somehow to be both a good analyst and a good activist on the social and political issues I deeply cared about. Since then, for more than 40 years, I have been extremely fortunate to have had a fulfilling career teaching, researching, writing, advising, and advocating for the rights of refugees and vulnerable people around the world. I have traveled throughout Asia, Africa, the Middle East, and Central America, visiting and working with those people. Some refugees are warehoused in protracted situations along remote borders. Others try to eke out livings in urban shanty towns. These are people who were forced to leave their homes to seek safety elsewhere. 14 years ago this August, I was on temporary mission to the United Nations in Baghdad. I was there to help the UN decide whether it was safe for Iraqi refugees to return home now that Saddam Hussein had been overthrown. While I was meeting with the head of the UN mission and several members of his staff, a suicide bomber attacked the building in a truck loaded with over a ton of explosives. Everyone in our meeting room was killed except me. I spent several hours buried in the rubble, kept alive and conscious by two American firemen. I remember promising myself I would not die there. I survived and spent the next several years recovering and adjusting to a new life in a wheelchair. What kept me going both then and now has been not only the strong support from my family and friends, but also my lifelong experience with refugees. From them, I have learned about courage, inner strength, and perseverance. Even in the most harrowing and difficult circumstances, they inspire me to be a better person and to continue to work on their behalf. The particular problems and challenges facing the world's refugees were somewhat less visible to the general public when I began working in the field some 40 years ago. Today, while the refugee problem is not new, the numbers of refugees and other forced migrants throughout the world continue to rise. At the same time, the rise of angry populist politicians in the West is aggravating an already incendiary situation. Intolerant politicians and commentators use fear and often unsupported security concerns to adopt exclusionary and discriminatory policies towards refugees. At the same time, the international community is failing to protect and assist them adequately. History has shown that America needs immigration, and refugees are an important part of that. What is your family history? Unless you are a Native American, you are of immigrant stock, maybe even descended from a refugee. For someone to imply that we have no need of immigrants and refugees shows a profound ignorance of our nation's history and a lack of faith in its future. The global refugee problem cannot be solved without effective collective action led by the United States. America has a mixed political history regarding the acceptance of refugees. At times, generous, and at times, calculating and unduly selective. When we are at our best, we are generous and compassionate. Our country has for many years embraced immigrants and refugees from around the world. And by doing so, has earned for itself a reputation as a land of opportunity and a beacon of freedom in the world. I think it is terrible that some people in positions of power relentlessly politicize the current refugee crisis and refuse to even admit that we should be compassionate. And yet, at the same time, I find it remarkable and heartwarming that so many Americans continue to reach out to desperate refugee populations with that same compassion and decency that is often lacking in many political spheres. Compassion is the reason we welcome refugees, and they repay that with a new and invigorated patriotism. My friend and colleague, the international human rights lawyer, Arthur Helton, who was killed in the suicide bombing in Baghdad that injured me, once wrote that refugees matter most fundamentally because at some level, we all realize that but for the accident of birth and circumstance, we could all be refugees ourselves. I would add that refugees also matter because they are a litmus test of how tolerant and just we are as individuals, as a society, and as a nation. Today, you are all embarking on your own futures. You will have your own triumphs and tragedies. It is easy to conform to the status quo and to be content to simply acquire the credentials that will improve your status or position in society. But some of you are disturbed by the society and world around you and long to explore alternative possibilities. Those of you who feel this way should be encouraged by the knowledge that history contains repeated examples of hope, of resistance by individuals and organizations who have sought to achieve a more compassionate and just future. I invite you to consider your own futures carefully. I also encourage you to be true to the universal truths and values you have been taught here at Lawrence. We live in an interconnected and challenging world, full of people just like us, only different. Celebrate those differences. Remember that you are a citizen of the world, not just a citizen of this country. We need to listen to, work with, and understand others. The search for knowledge is lifelong, and your greatest asset will be an open mind. Thank you again for inviting me to address you today. Congratulations and all the best to each and every one of you. And to your success.